a champagne supernova in the sky. I used to think that the day would never come. Pack up my bags and break in. This drive seems cooked me like a man. Listen to the silence, let it ring on. High star, great lens is bright under the sun.
Manchester's music scene is colourful and varied and has a huge range of genres, which is appealing to every type of music lover. It has a history of indie music, but with new music being introduced every day, we're going to find out how diverse it really is. I'm here outside Manchester's most famous venue, the Manchester Arena. It's the largest indoor capacity venue in the UK. It hosts all sorts of events and shows. And while many remember it for these comedy tours and music concerts, others remember it for the horrible events of the Manchester bombing. I'm here outside Band on the Wall. It started out having jazz, blues and international artists bringing their music to Manchester, but became more famous in the Manchester music scene having the Buzzcocks, The Fall and Joy Division played in the 70s. This was the post-punk era in music.
An artist who made a name at Band on the Wall is EvaBEE. We sent Charlie to meet her.
So, I've come to see EvaBEE, a local Mancunian artist, and we just want to know what she thinks of how diverse the Manchester music scene is, her influences. We're at a practice room right now.
This is my studio and my crib sometimes. Oh, artwork by Pete Obsolete. Absolute bad man in the game. Enter with love.
I'm here with EvaBEE.
Hello.
Lovely to meet you.
Lovely to see you too, pal.
Can you tell us why EvaBEE is the name?
Well, my name's Eva, and BEE is because I represent where I'm from. The Manchester Bee has always been like a prolific symbol in my like life and upbringing. You know, work a bee. So I thought I'll bring that into my artist name, and it's really nice when I perform as well, and it's like EvaBEE, and I make it a kind of thing like EvaBEE, because I'm from Manny, like yeah. That's my little tag.
We asked Eva what her favourite Manchester venue to play was.
There's a running event at Band on the Wall, and that was like my first headline show as EvaBEE, and I think that was probably my favourite, because like so many people turned up from my past and people who had not spoke to in years, and the room was full, and I love the sound there, and the engineer is top, and I just got such lovely vibes, and I got was treated so well. Like Band on the Wall is definitely my favourite venue, like hands down in Manchester.
What is that event?
Yeah, it's called Inner City Waves. It's run by an amazing lady who's fully active in the scene called Santana. And it is Lottery Arts Council funded, so they can afford to have like all the artists in Manchester and bring also artists from outside of Manchester onto the stage, and it really does showcase what we're about, and it puts artists together, and it's a great way of networking as well. I've met like quite a few artists there and been able to see them perform, not just in like a networking event where you don't really know what people are about. I've been able to see people perform and then link up with them, so it's a really good idea and it's a really good event.
Yeah.
We asked Eva which artists from Manchester have inspired her and what's influenced her music.
In the past year, where I've come as an artist myself, Children of Zeus, Layfull Stop, do you know what, the list goes on really. King Kai, HMD, Sleeps. These are people who have really taken their influences and like wrapped it up and like got a brand new sound and still keeping so true to the roots, but also putting something brand new into the scene.
Yeah, that bringing stuff brand new that makes Manchester's music scene quite diverse.
Yeah, definitely.
How diverse do you think it is?
It's mad. Like even this building alone, we're in Wellington House now, best place in the world. There's like punk bands down there. There's grime producers. There's band rehearsals. So you're hearing all kinds. It's like a Brazilian, like ballet funk steel band, which are amazing. Like it the list just goes absolutely on. But that's why we're so rich. We've got something special. Like as Chunky, like as an artist in Manny called Chunky, and as he says, and DRS says, there's something in the water in Manchester, because we've got something so special here.
And it's a city life, just a throwaway from where I saw my life pass before me like I know.
For quite a while, Manchester's music scene has been, it's been kind of labelled with like Oasis, Stone Roses and stuff like that, like the Madchester stuff.
Yeah.
Where do you see it going? And do you think you'll be involved in that? And where do you see your career?
Otherwise it's a waste of time. Do you know what, like, not to discredit them artists, like they are amazing, but Oasis, Stone Roses, I tweeted this, so this is a good question. And like Bugsy Malone, they're not the be all and end all of our city, although they've got their, you know, podium, they're on the podium and all eyes are on them. This city holds so much amazing talent and like soul, like not just soul music, but we have something really special, and what we're just trying to do is keep collaborating together, keep doing what we need to do, and you know, let the world see it. We have to just keep going.
I've come to Whitworth Street in Manchester to see where former nightclub Hacienda used to be. Hacienda was active in Manchester years in the 80s through to the 90s. I sent Charlie Andrew to have a chat with Herbie Saccani, a former DJ of Hacienda.
So Herbie, for people who don't know, what was the Hacienda and what was it to you?
Well, it's a mixture of things really, that's in what it means to me. It's an iconic establishment in Manchester, which was the first of its kind really in the north and the south. There's only something going on down south called Shoe. It influenced lots of labels, lots of DJs, a lot of them still playing today. Really, I was far too young for it all because I was at school, but I just literally, seriously, used to listen to that music on my headphones and dream about DJing in the Hacienda. On New Year's Eve, the year before I started playing, I was at a party with my mates and it was really, really bad. It was so poor, this party. I was on the decks and I turned around and I said, this is terribly sad, this is so sad, look at us, we're all skint. And this is just really boring. I said, right, this time next New Year's Eve I'm going to be DJing at the Hacienda and all that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And there was. Well, 1991, I got my decks. I started DJing in the Hacienda in 93.
Yeah.
Yeah, 91. I was only about that big. So what I actually did was decide to promote myself a little bit. And then when I was in the Hacienda as a punter, I'd give out my tapes and I'd go to Dry Bar, which was their bar. And I'd give out my tapes there and I'd make sure the bar staff would get them and everything like that. I'd make sure my tapes, yeah, I'm saying tapes, because they were proper tapes. Graham Park was obviously DJing in the Hacienda, he didn't DJ in Dry Bar with me, and he said, do you want to DJ in the club? And it just went like that, and that's when I ended up doing, which is why I was here, the Cream of Manchester tour thing, which at the time, it was quite prestigious to do this. It was a Boddington's tour for the Hacienda around the UK. I was playing with like pretty big heavyweights like Tony Humphries, who's like on the same level of people like Frankie Knuckles and stuff like that.
Okay. So is this where we get onto things like acid house?
Yeah, because what happened, there was quite a few people travelling over, because in 87, before acid house, without acid house, you've got to have house.
Yeah.
Right? So you've got people like Larry Levan, Marshall Jefferson, and people like that who were obviously involved in the gay music scene in America. And you have disco, funk, and all that, and basically they strip down those tracks and emphasised on the 4/4 beat with the 808 drum machine. So they ended up doing the original house tracks in 87, 86 actually, 87. And then along comes the Roland 303, which is the classic acid blip noise. So a guy called DJ Pierre and DJ Pierre and Marshall Jefferson started Acid House, and it went from there. But alongside that, because all that was happening in Chicago, alongside that in Detroit, you had people like Derek May, Kevin Saunderson, and they were producing their version of house, which were, you know, they sat down and said, let's call it techno.
How do you think like the Manchester music scene is diverse?
Well, again, I think that's when people, you know, bands just like Joy Division and New Order and Factory Records, and also 1991 of the Manchester scene. That wasn't all dance music. Well, it was indie dance, wasn't it? But, you know, it had a guitar-based rock influence to it. But I think it's really diverse because, aside to all of that, before that, you know, you've got a lot of Northern Soul stuff going on.
Yeah.
And, which is a huge history of Manchester and the black music scene in Manchester. Without all of that, we wouldn't be here musically, I don't think.
After hearing what Herbie had to say, we thought we'd visit one of Manchester's venues. I sent Charlie to the Star and Garter Pub in Manchester to see what range of artists they get and their opinion on the diversity of the Manchester music scene.
So I'm here with Dan and Danny from the Star and Garter. What are your favourite bands that have played here?
Spunk Volcano and The Eruptions.
When I was a lot younger, I came here as a customer. I had some really cool indie bands on, like Low, Los Campesinos, The School, Help Stamp Out Loneliness, Kimmy Dawson from Moldy Peaches. We had Nine Blackouts, Cortinas, things like that, really. I don't like any of the metal stuff we have on or the punk, really.
Yeah. I mean, there's even a Cortinas song about the Smiths.
It is a punter, really.
We mentioned it too. Modern Lovers or something, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Smiths Disco as well.
Do you think that the iconic Smiths Disco gets better every time, and do you find that it's mainly the regulars, or do you get a new crowd in?
I think we have about, the place holds 200, but I reckon we've 400 to 500 regulars, and they're almost like, they're not going to come to everyone because people come from like Birmingham, London, Scotland, we get people coming from America. So then it might be one or two, and then I think we have like an hardcore of Manchester people who are based here, and then obviously there's an influx of students every year, so you do get some new people.
Do you think that Star and Garter has helped a lot of artists like get into the Manchester music scene, or just help them in general get bigger?
Gives them something to do.
I think it gives bands a leg up because I think we can give them a platform. So where we'll have, all you need to do to play this place is basically email the venue, book it, we've got a PA in place, you get a sound engineer. All it needs is for people to come and promote their own gig. So it's a great learning curve for bands to come see, you know, get to a bigger audience than just playing to the mates or something.
So you'd highly recommend like an upcoming band that's starting out to try it?
Yeah, definitely. Just book a don't have to be the Star and Garter, book a room.
Yeah.
Get somebody on the door, play, get a couple of your mates' bands on and go for it. It's the only way. And then you learn everything. You learn all about promotion, self-promotion, your merchandise side of it, because that's vital for a band these days, especially with like Spotify and Apple. You don't really sell many records anymore.
I think you can tell a band that comes through here that hasn't done that, because they instantly look like immature. Yeah, just amateur. Yeah, it's just you can tell a band that's had to sort of graft themselves and go out and get gigs for themselves because they just know what the crap is instantly. Whereas like with other bands, they are just rank amateur.
What is your opinion on the Manchester music scene and how diverse do you think it is?
I think it's really diverse. I think, but you have to go looking. I think at the top, you've got Cortinas, Blossoms, things like that, you know, that are mainstream. I think if you chisel under it, bands like he just said, Songs for Walter, constantly gigging. There's loads of bands, there's loads of little record labels, loads of spaces for them to play now. Not just this one, it's like, yes. Which is a really good sort of thing. It's going to be one just up here called Fairfield Social Club. And a lot of like local bands can play there. And I think you've got everything from rock through to rap, metal, punk, absolutely every genre covered in Manchester. And I think that's been the case for 30 years.
Another figure in the scene helping new artists from all genres is Paul Bow, who owns Viaduct Studios in Stockport, where bands such as Blossoms practice. I sent Charlie in the evening.
What inspired you to start Viaduct Studios?
So basically 2-3 years ago, I was a music teacher to start with, and I really loved teaching, did that for about 10 years all over Stockport and Manchester. And an opportunity to use an investment when I walked through the building here to expand, because a lot of rehearsal studios and recording studios were getting knocked down. All these old mills were about 200 or 300 years old, and every studio was getting levelled. No places for anybody to go and rehearse. So there was kind of, it was like an epidemic of closure, and this just kind of happened very kind of out of the blue. It wasn't even planned really. So when we came, we collaborated with the owner of this mill. We said, okay, right, let's put everything we can into it. Let's make as many rooms as we can. Let's make it as cheap as we can, and let's make sure that it's open 7 days a week. You know, for the rest of the year. And I also wanted to kind of attract, you know, some decent names, you know, so bands of all levels and ages and abilities could be around bands that are, you know, doing really well, you know, to be inspired and to be influenced. And in a 2-year plan that we've been at, it's worked really well. So,
so you have like a broad range of artists, like genres coming in there?
There is no, it's, I mean, we have everything from, we get choirs, we get, you know, young bands in the teens that are just that, it's their first ever band and their first ever jam. We've got, you know, big names, big chart bands coming and doing rehearsing and producing, doing stage productions for big tours. So, you know, it's this space is available for anybody at any time.
We asked him how he thought his rehearsal rooms have helped bands around Manchester.
I think for obviously the Stockport, Manchester, Greater Manchester kind of thing, you know, we want to kind of describe that. There's a definite hub and culture for rehearsal spaces, like I said, for the mills. And it will attract basically a lot of people from outside of Manchester when you've got a big name coming here. So we've got people coming from Liverpool. The furthest people coming is London, Edinburgh. If they're coming on tour, you know, kind of attracting anybody from everywhere because you're right near the motorway as well. And they have that whole 7 miles out from the Stockport and Manchester's kind of bridge, but it's musical heritage and tradition. So with Viaduct Studios, I wanted to try and make it as a brand and to inspire young people to come and just start playing.
What is your like favourite Manchester band and like, song by Manchester artists?
That's a good question. I don't have to do in terms of Manchester band. I've always liked, I mean, they're not really Manchester, but they are Manchester. I mean, the Verve were a big thing for me. I liked Joy Division a lot. And Oasis, I'm gonna say Oasis, back in the 90s I was a big Oasis fan as well. So, I mean, in terms of those three bands from Manchester, those would be the three. But in terms of a song, I can't give you one. I couldn't tell you. There's too many great songs out there. I'd have to come back to you on that.
We then asked him how diverse he thinks Manchester's music scene is.
I think it is. I think it always has been. But I think it's got a definite, what it always has is an identity as well. Like, that's the only word I could probably explain. If you go to London, it's probably a little bit more diverse. A lot more diverse than say Manchester's certainly got its own identity, but Liverpool has as well. But in terms of diverse range of bands, I think we've got in terms of rock and roll. You know, that's where my standpoint is. So there's a lot of everything. And the indie scene at the moment is thriving. I mean, the promoters and venues popping up every week. You know, small venues for people to play, even though our venues closing down, which is a problem. It's enabling all those diverse acts in different genres to play anywhere. You can do anything you want these days, and there'll be an audience for it in Manchester always.
So, what is your opinion on the Manchester music scene?
I think it's healthy. I think, going back again, because it's got an identity and it's got a strong heritage, I don't think it'll ever dip in terms of its quality, its diversity. I think that identity will remain, and people want to come here, people want to meet musicians in Manchester. And because it's so thrive, because the nightlife, and because there's so much to go and see and do, that inspires people to continue its tradition and its trend and getting in a band and, you know, keeping the music scene in Manchester robust. I think it's a healthy thing.
We spoke to David Hughes from a local Stockport indie band, The Panamas, for his take on how diverse Manchester's music scene is.
Who are your musical influences?
So, I picked up the guitar when I was younger, and then it was more like a bit rockier, like Jimi Hendrix, things like that. But then I got into all like the Manchester music, like Johnny Marr, John Squire, and all the Stone Roses, Smiths, they're my main influences, and they influence my band's music.
Alright, so you say you're in a band. How long have you been in a band?
Since the age of 12, actually. It's like 6 years now, yeah. Cause you don't think twice when I'm gone. Doing some gigs in Manchester now, like in some good venues like Atmer. Club Academy, Atmer, we just did Factory. There's loads of venues in Manchester, so it's got quite a good scene.
What do you think the best Manchester band is?
Stone Roses. And then it's Battle for Smiths and Oasis. But I think, just for consistency, Smiths might take it, but yeah.
Thanks very much for your time.
We went to Piccadilly Records in Manchester to see what their opinion is on the Manchester music scene. We spoke to Patrick, who works there.
How diverse is the Manchester music scene?
Well, I guess it's really broad, I suppose. There's, especially at the moment, there's loads of like kind of grime and R&B stuff, then electronic music, dance music, club music, and obviously there's loads of guitar bands like they're always happening.
Yeah. So. Are you finding that as like the genres are filled and you get a bigger variety of people coming to the shop?
We've always had a pretty wide, like a diverse range of people in here, especially because we've always stocked things that are across different genres, really. I guess the popularity of them in Manchester does make a difference. I guess it's the same as ever, really, but maybe there's more, maybe now you get less people who just come in and browse and more people who specifically have a thing that they want to come and get.
Piccadilly Records is known all around Manchester, so we asked Patrick why he thinks it's so iconic.
It's been here a long time, I guess, but it's always kind of had a reputation for stocking good records, for having knowledgeable and approachable staff, and you know, there's a lot of people who bought records here, and a lot of people who bought their first records here, so I guess that's a special thing.
We finally asked him what his opinion on the Manchester music scene was.
Yeah, really good. It's interesting to have a scene that can have people like IMDb, Levels, at the same time as you've got people who kind of take something from that, like Pearl City have the kind of retroist 90s thing going on, but it's not R&B.
Yeah.
It's like kind of vaporwave, really. So you've got that, and then at the same time you've got like people like Rough Dog making Street Soul Revival. You've got a load of great techno producers. People like Heron or House, they do great things. Labels like Natural Sciences on one end of the spectrum, and then you've got like really soulful, jazzy things from like Church from Ad Hoc, which following the like soulful path that those guys set up. So it's pretty broad.
Yeah.
This is, you know, there's everything on the band side. You've got people who came out of here, like Horse Beach, and there's a few bands that sound like them, but then, you know, Blossoms blown up and been massive and they're like a big thing. So I guess there's something for everyone. All genres covered really at the moment. It's good. It's interesting.
I think that's everything.
Alright, amazing. You're welcome.
Nice one.
Today we're going to be going around Manchester, speaking to people, talking about the famous Manchester music scene, seeing how diverse it is, people's favourite Manchester bands, just finding out a bit more about it. What's your favourite Manchester band?
Stone Roses, Gobby Stone Roses, Sally Cinnamon.
Mercury Machine.
Probably the Smiths. But artist, I'd probably say H.
Okay.
What's your opinion on the Manchester music scene?
Oh, it's out of this world. Like, there's no other city that has music like Manchester. It's insane. It's on like another level. You can't go to another city and have the same kind of history of music as Manchester, I think. Definitely through the Britpop era as well.
There's a lot of talent here. It's undiscovered talent. So
I think it's really good at the moment. I think there's quite a few different types of bands coming through. I mean, you mentioned Blossoms earlier, which obviously kind of one of the big, more popular ones, but there's a lot of smaller stuff as well. I mean, like the Slow Readers Club are doing really well at the moment also. So I think the fact that they've been doing lots is pretty good for a lot of bands here at the moment.
It's diverse, a lot, can get anything really, can't you? Anything, obviously from the 80s, 90s, Oasis, Stone Roses and that. And then more recently, like grime, like Bugs and Malone.
After speaking to loads of different people and getting different opinions on the Manchester music scene, I've come to the conclusion that it's not only about Oasis and Stone Roses, people like that. It's a bit something for everyone, loads of underground stuff going around, isn't it, Charlie?
Yeah, I agree. I found that Manchester's music scene was very diverse and will hopefully carry on for many years to come. It's the light that never goes out.